Part 8. The Self-Destruct Con Men's Cult. The Solar Temple. Many cult leaders look pretty transparent con men, but then so do many perfectly legit car salesmen, lawyers, and party politicians. A few cult leaders, however, seem even less genuinely motivated by the will to serve truth and their fellow men than a local government committee chairman on the fiddle. Luc Jure and Joseph de Mambro seem to have set up the International Chivalric Order Solar tradition as a high-powered swindle, and pulled it down when the membership and the Canadian police were on the verge of exposing their nefarious activities. Jure was a Belgian doctor, born in the Congo in 1947. He graduated from the Free University of Brussels 27 years later, and with his dark good looks and educated manners seemed likely to prove a success whatever field of specialization he chose. Initially, he intended to be an obstetrician, but after travels in Asia and the Philippines had brought him in touch with various forms of native medicine and mysticism, he changed direction entirely, and returned to France at the end of the 1970s as a homeopath. Homeopathy is one of the older and more respectable of the alternative medicines. Like the earliest European and Arabian physicians, homeopaths prescribe tinctures, potions or pills in which dissolved and redissolved and redissolved doses of herbs or drugs give a tiny trace only of the original curative, instead of the large measured doses of chemically tested drugs used in orthodox allopathic medicine. It is usual for a homeopathic doctor to have basic training in orthodox anatomy and diagnosis, though one highly esteemed practitioner 50 years ago built his homeopathy on a basis of osteopathic training in the therapeutic manipulation of the joints. Benjamin Disraeli patronized a homeopathic doctor and introduced the royal family to the discipline. It's believed that some royals to this day prefer homeopathic treatment. Homeopathy, like most alternative medicines, claims vaguely to be more natural than allopathy. And this fitted with Jure's growing passion for nature and the environment. Like many of his generation, he was increasingly concerned about industrial pollution and the threat to health and the ecology posed by man's scientific and technological depredations on planet Earth. A glance at Jure's later career, however, may suggest a more cynical reason for Jure's abjuring obstetrics in favour of homeopathy. His future huge successes as a con man came via associations with the male worlds of business, politics, and administration. Jure would prove expert at wheedling rich and successful men of affairs into accepting his cranky teachings and making over money for his weird ventures. Obstetrics would have restricted his professional attentions to women, and women whose anticipation of imminent childbearing might well put their feet squarely on the ground and lead them to see better ways of protecting their forthcoming offspring from ecological disaster than going up to the mountaintops, putting on Disney World robes and uttering mystic mumbo-jumbo. Would men really be more likely to go in for this codswallop? Well, a woman will often think of Freemasonry as her husband going out with his little friends of an evening to put on silly clothes and medals, and play-act with silly titles, and generally have the silly harmless fun of being a little boy in a gang, giving himself totally spurious but harmless importance among his mates. You do sometimes think something like that, don't you, ma'am? The Freemasons, or their offshoots, anyway, were the rich soil in which Jure cultivated his talent for making friends and influencing people. Not, I'm afraid, the harmless bufferish or Rotarianish mainstream, where the trouser-rolling and secret oaths are just a sort of game preceding a jolly good meal among friends and some general chit-chat about future charitable work. But the higher degrees of Masonry, which seem so sinister to the paranoid, and so pathetically empty to the historically or spiritually minded. The esoteric edges, where really ridiculous lore, purporting to be handed down from the Middle Ages, is secretly revealed to initiates as though it contained vital truths. Jure got himself into a Masonic splinter, calling itself the Renewed Order of the Temple. This group claimed to hold the secrets of the Knights Templar or their heirs. The suggestion is not quite so silly as it sounds. A powerful and far-flung institution, like a medieval multinational company, was suppressed and persecuted from 1307. Its employees and their dependents were liable to be arrested, tortured, and burned as Satanists if the authorities found them anywhere. Their occupation was gone. Yet they had clandestine friends and sympathizers in various places, and wanted to help each other if they could. What more natural than that they should devise and spread a system of secret signs and rituals by which to know and help each other? Certainly, a far better case can be made for this as the origin of Freemasonry than the official story of the Masons being the old Workman's Craft Guild of peripatetic stonemasons, travelling from town to town to build and repair cathedrals and churches. Quite simply, nobody has ever found a shred of evidence for the existence of any such organized travelling stonemasons, and nobody has ever given a sensible reason for their resorting to deep secrecy when all their contemporary guilds of fixed workers were perfectly open and above board. The renewed order of the Temple was headed by an ex-Gestapo officer called Julian Arrigas. Nazism had included a good dollop of covert superstition and occultism, a surface cover of nature-loving, and obvious skill with costumes and theatricals. All these things were brought into the renewed order, which dressed up to go through its rituals in a medieval castle. Jure prospered in the renewed order until, after Arrigas' death in the mid-80s, there was a serious dispute over the group's finances. Jure moved away on his own, and some renewed order members came with him. In Switzerland, he set up an entirely new and independent movement of his own, calling it the International Chivalric Order Solar Tradition, or more briefly, the Solar Temple. He replaced ancient and turgid pseudo-philosophy with trendy New Age pseudo-scientific prophecy. "Ecological catastrophe was at hand," he proclaimed. "The solar temple would organize themselves to survive." An older man, leading a similar quasi-Masonic group in Geneva, joined him. Joseph de Mambro, a subtle financier and investment analyst, dissolved his foundation Golden Way into the solar temple and took over handling the order's money. He also handed over the promising information that he had personally been a Knight Templar in a former life and still owned a sword he had been given 1,000 years ago. Perhaps the well-heeled adepts would have been less willing to bequeath and subscribe had they realized that de Mambro served a prison sentence for falsely pretending to be a psychologist and for financial fraud in the early 1970s. Moreover, that he'd once fled to Canada to escape income tax problems in Switzerland. Well-heeled the members had to be. To belong to the simplest and lowest of the three orders in the Solar Temple cost a weekly subscription of $50. The humble members heard lectures and bought inspirational tapes. For $150 a week, they could be members of the Club Arcadia, and become more deeply involved in rituals. They would also be expected to work with or contribute to the organic farming ventures the order promoted. The inner ring was the Golden Circle, the Chevaliers or Knights of Christ. They coughed up $200 a week and were expected to hand over additional property and savings to the order. The big lure Jure and de Mambro held out was the promise that when, in the near future, ecological apocalypse overtook the Earth, the best 100 members of the Solar Temple would be spirited away to Sirius the Dog Star, the brightest of the fixed stars in the sky, there to live an ecologically sound existence while poor old Earth shriveled up. And who swallowed this horse manure? Embarrassingly sophisticated people who should have known better, like the businessman son of an Olympic ski champion. People who came to Dr. Jure for private homeopathic treatment in Geneva and accepted his argument that their doctor should also be their priest. People who gave Jure and de Mambro sufficient funds to travel around proselytizing in Canada and Australia. The Solar Temple was particularly successful in French-speaking Quebec. Jure seems to have managed brilliantly the old Masonic dodge of using lodge acquaintance to further business contacts, and then played it back on itself again, using business contacts to recruit new members for the Solar Temple. He became a frequent lecturer and facilitator at the inspirational courses and conferences in motivation and self-improvement which so many businesses inflicted on their managers in the 1980s. Hydro-Québec, the province's electricity-generating company, was particularly rewarding for him. He gave a series of seminars on self-realization and management for them, and gained about 20 recruits for self-improvement through the Solar Temple. By the time he had 300 or so members in France and Switzerland, and several hundred more in Canada, they were generating enough cash to keep Demambro very happy, investing and shifting money around the world. Millions of dollars were being laundered and squirreled away in banks on three continents. Demambro was spending $35,000 a month through his credit card, and he and Jure were trying to arrange big religious ceremonies at world-famous sites like Ayers Rock and Stonehenge. Demambro also handled discipline in the order. He brought elderly and tyrannical habits from the old Foundation Golden Way, and he used them on his new army of adepts. The old tricks of separating husbands from wives and ordering the dissolution of marriages were pulled out, and devotion to the leaders was encouraged, along with ever-increasing paranoia about the ecological threat posed by unconverted industrial man. Things started going wrong in the 1990s. Demambro had invested too much of the portfolio in real estate, and earnings began to fall as property values plummeted. Robert Falardeau, an official in the Quebec Finance Ministry, had secretly joined the cult. He had to leave his job and fly to Switzerland to sort out some of Demambro's dodgy deals. Soon after that, the Canadian Knights of Christ suggested that Falardeau would make a better cult leader than Jure. Jure and Demambro spent a lot of time in 1993 and most of 1994 crossing and recrossing the Atlantic to try and keep their Canadian house of cards from tumbling. The Royal Canadian Mounted Police were investigating the cult on three counts. It was believed that as much as $95 million might have been illegally moved out of the country for laundering. It was reported that the cult was stockpiling arms against the coming cataclysm. And it was rumoured that they were hand in glove with a loony batch of right-wing extremist paramilitaries, calling themselves Q-37, who planned to blow up Hydro-Québec plant and assassinate politicians. In 1993, Jure was fined $750 for possession of illegal weapons, including gun silencers. He protested that he was being persecuted. And his followers, had they known history, might have avoided repeating it. He started to preach that a fast and fiery death for all of them might be necessary. It would be a revolutionary step into life. It would bring them all to Sirius, which, oddly, many who heard Jure apparently described as a planet rather than a star. The day of cataclysm was at hand. The batty paranoia fed on itself. Many of the group agreed and drafted letters threatening their own unspecific death as a warning to the world and the persecuting authorities. The trigger of primary violence came from a baby. Demambro maintained that his 12-year-old daughter Emmanuelle was the cosmic child, conceived without sex and destined to lead the order when he and Jure had translated to some yet more distant heavenly body. But he thought Emmanuelle's birthright was threatened in July when his chauffeur handyman Antonio Dutoit and his British wife Nikki had a baby and named him Christopher Emmanuel. Demambro objected that Dutoit's had not had permission from him to procreate. As September turned to October, he gave orders that they and their upstart baby, now recognized as the Antichrist Beast of Revelations, hey-ho, yet again, were to be killed. And in a duplex ski chalet north of Montreal that the cult owned, somebody obeyed him. The threatening Antichrist was ritually murdered with a stake through his heart and a plastic bag over his head. Then the baby's body was hidden behind a water heater, while its knifed parents were hidden in the basement. frenzied transatlantic travelling and conferring began. Falardeau received a mysterious telephone call in Canada and promptly flew to Switzerland. Robert Ostiguier, mayor of Richelieu, south of Montreal, and Jocelyne Grandmaison, a Quebec newspaper reporter, also flew to Switzerland, indicating to a few intimates that they were going to help sort out new financial problems. The pair had been secret Solar Templars for years. A few nights later, Jureuil, Dimambro, and seven others held a doom-laden meeting in the Canadian hotel where Falardeau had been staying before he left. On October the 3rd, Dimambro and 12 disciples held a Last Supper in Montreal. On October the 4th, he and Jureuil were seen leaving the chalet where the Dutoit family's bodies lay concealed. It seems the two cult leaders flew to Switzerland that night. As their plane was touching down in Zurich, the chalet they had left in Canada burst into flames. Firefighters found a man and a woman in a bedroom wearing the Solar Temple's double-headed eagle medallions. Later they found the Dutoits in the basement. Later still, they found little Christopher Emmanuel behind the heater. And finally, specialist examination of the gutted building to find out the cause of the fire established that it had been booby-trapped with explosive devices and bags of petrol, which must have been set off by someone leaving the building. But before all that had become clear, there were yet more dramatic explosions in Switzerland. Around midnight, a huge fireball and a sequence of lesser explosions signalled the end of Albert Jacobini's large farmhouse near Chéry, north of Geneva. Inside, rescuers found 72-year-old Jacobini dead in his bed, shot. But much weirder was the discovery in a large barn. Its interior had been converted into a sumptuous temple. Its walls were hung with red satin. Its floor was carpeted with a pentagram inscribed on the carpet. A triangular pulpit was backed by a large painting of a messianic figure holding a chalice with an aura-like rose over its head. The figure bore a strong resemblance to Luc Jureuil. The horror was the 23 bodies. They lay sprawled in a dramatic circle on the carpet. 10 men in the white, black, and red robes of the three respective ranks in the temple, 12 women in white and gold robes, and Emmanuel de Mambry, the cosmic child. Several of the dead had plastic bags tied over their heads. This, it seemed, was a penitential ritual act by which the cult sometimes deplored industrialism and pollution. Many of them had not gone willingly to their deaths. Several had their hands tied, and 20 of the 23 had been shot with 22 bullets, although no gun of that caliber could be found anywhere on the farm. Oh, and the cult was gold-plated to the last. Empty champagne bottles lay around the scene of the mass suicide, a far cry from Jim Jones's purple Kool-Aid. Reminiscent of Jones, however, was the presence of a tape deck with a cassette recording a rambling harangue about astrology and the end of the world and the possibility of mass suicide. 4 hours later, and 50 miles away, came the last of the Solar Temple's pyrotechnic celebrations of the Day of Cataclysm. 3 ski chalets at Grange-sur-Salvin exploded just before dawn. 25 bodies were found in beds there, 5 children, 10 women, 10 men. Among their number, the 3 travelling Canadian secret cultists, Falardeau, Ostiguier, and Grandmaison. None were tied up, but some had been beaten. None had been shot, though the 22 pistol that had been used at Chéry lay on the floor. High-tech medicine, allopathic rather than homeopathic, had been used. Half-melted syringes, intravenous drips, and tranquilizers lay around. These cult suicides had drugged themselves before letting the explosion carry them away. Some had donned the penitential plastic bags over their heads before preparing for the long journey to the Dog Star. First suspicion was inevitably that Jureuil and Dimambro had used the persuasive call of ritual suicide to rid themselves of suspicious followers and made their way to anonymous safety in some distant place. But dental charts indicated that this was not the case. The two had swallowed their own con as their world fell apart and lay with their dead disciples in the chalets. The message to confidence tricksters is clear. Beware of setting up a cult. Avoid Ron Hubbard's seductive observation that establishing a new religion is the best con of all. You may start believing your own twaddle. And that way lies not only madness, but possible violent death and despair.